Good morning, everyone. John Hudson, I'm the pastor here at Pilgrim Church, United Church of Christ at 25 South Main Street in Sherburn, Massachusetts. And for those who are here and for those who are at home or watching at a later time, I welcome you. I welcome you on this second Sunday in January, on the day when we celebrate Epiphany and the visit of the wise man to baby Jesus. It's kind of the day when we conclude all of our Christmas celebrations. And I don't know about you guys, I'm kind of a little sad and reluctant about that. So I actually am going to keep up some of my lights until the spring, because I feel like we all need a little light right now. So first of all, can we have some applause for David's musical piece? That was absolutely wonderful. There are a few things other than music that, at least for me, can center me, especially in the midst of craziness, in the midst of a world that we know in the last 12 months has not felt very stable, in a world where we can see a lot of people doing a lot of good, but we can also see some people doing not so good. And in a world where we need a place to stand, not just as Christians, but as human beings. I've often wondered, and I don't mean this in a judgmental kind of way, but how one could live this life without some system of belief to frame our lives, to understand it, to bring meaning and purpose to our lives, especially in 2021 and now 2020 and now 2021. And so no matter how you're feeling this day as you come in, no matter how you're doing, where your heart is, when you're sitting at home, I would invite you to be centered in our community, to be centered in the good, to be centered in hope, and to be centered in community. So could I get an amen for that, please? All right. Just a couple of announcements this day. On Sunday, February 3rd, we will be holding our annual meeting. That's the gathering where we talk about and adopt a ministry budget for the new year and elect committees and officers and any other business that happens to come before us. Obviously, this year is going to be a little different. We'll have a limited number of people here at the church, and then we're inviting people to participate by Zoom. And we're going to work really hard to make plans to make sure that everybody can fully participate. And so please keep that in mind. Just a reminder that our office is now closed, that not so much closed as we've gone remote, but we're checking the messages and the emails every day. There are emergency numbers on there. There are numbers if there's a problem with the building, but we're still connected. But given that this week the largest number of COVID cases were reported in the state of Massachusetts, we just think it's a good idea to kind of step away for a bit. We're offering two classes going into the winter and spring. We offered them last fall, and I would invite you to consider being a part of them. They're all online and on Zoom. The first is I lead a writing class called Writing About Your Life on Thursday nights from 7 to 8. It's a wonderful time to come together and use writing as a spiritual discipline and to kind of dig deeper into your own life and your own faith. And then on Wednesday nights, and I believe it's from 7 to 8, Pastor Diane is leading a Good Neighbor book group, and that group reads a challenging and smart and good book every month or so, and that's a wonderful thing to be a part of as well, so I'd invite you to be that. And then finally, as we do twice a month, we'll gather together for a virtual coffee hour at 11:15. If you go to our website or our Facebook page, you can see the Zoom link for it then. And so at this time, even though we're not allowed to get too close to each other, I'd ask you to turn around to your left or right, back or front, and to give folks a greeting of peace. You can wave, you can give a peace sign, you can do whatever you'd like. I'd invite you to do that at home, too, because actually at home you can actually give a hug to people. And so, Dan, if you would lead us into worship.
Good morning. My name is Dan Geary. I'm one of the deacons here at Pilgrim Church. Today's reading is from Psalm 72, verses 1 through 7 and 18 through 20. Give the king your justice, O God, and your righteousness to a king's son. May he judge your people with righteousness and your poor with justice. May the mountains yield prosperity for the people and the hills in righteousness. May he defend the cause of the poor people. Give deliverance to the needy and crush the oppressor. May he live while the sun endures, as long as the moon, throughout all generations. May he be like rain that falls on mown grass, like showers that water the earth. In his days may righteousness flourish and peace abound until the moon is no more.
Our opening hymn this day can bound on your order of worship, and I invite those who are here and those who are at home to sing. It's the first Noel, verses 1-3. Please be seated. One of the things I really miss is standing out front with the door open in that doorway and watching people kind of park their cars and get out of their cars and walk towards church. Because one of the things I notice, and others may not notice it or you may notice it, is people come in kind of with different postures into church and you know, some kind of stride high and smiling, and some walk in kind of sleepily, and some walk in a little slumped or heavy-shouldered because they're bringing something into this place that they need to let go of. They're bringing a burden or a stumble. They're bringing fears that they might have about their own lives or about the life of this world. And they're bringing the deepest hopes of their lives, too. That's why we come together, to be like the wise men and be wise men and women in this time and place, and visit the Christ child and with humble hearts come before him and offer our full selves to that God of mercy and love. And so in the quiet places of our hearts this day, whether here or at home, I would invite you to enter into a time of confession of sin and assurance of pardon. God, we thank you this day for this sacred space, for all sacred spaces, for any place that we can gather in safety and in trust and meet you face to face and meet you and others we gather with too, God. We come and we bring our sins and our struggles. We bring our victories and the ways that we soar. We bring our whole selves to you, God. And we trust, God. We trust that always we are reconciled unto you, that forgiveness is ever coming, and that peace, peace at the last in you, is ours, ours, God, when we come fully to you. All in the name of the little baby, the Prince of Peace, the King, not an earthly king, but a king for all time and eternity. This teacher invites us all to pray together as a sign of our unity in him. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And I would invite Angie Johnson to come forward and to share with us a children's message for today.
My mask etiquette's not so great. Good morning. I'm Angie Johnson, and I'm the Christian Ed Director here. So this morning, we're going to talk about the wise men. And this is by far my favorite part of the Christmas story. To me, they are magical. In Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12, we hear there are three wise men, magi, and they studied the stars. They followed the Google map and the Waze directional voice all the way to see the baby Jesus. No, wait, that's not exactly right. There was no map or voice navigation or even someone to ask if you were lost. There was a really bright star. I don't know about you, but I have what I would say is a challenge sense of direction. When I first moved to Sherburn, I drove around for 40 minutes trying to find the transfer station. I live 5 minutes from the transfer station. My navigation actually took me to Medfield's transfer station. So you see what issue I would have had following a star. I can't even take the trash to the proper place when I have navigation. And following a star, I mean, it could have been cloudy that night. And I tell you, those stars, they seem to move around. So if it had been up to me, I would probably still be looking for the baby Jesus. And as I have said before, what do you buy baby Jesus? If you think finding the perfect gift is difficult, think about the wise men. No stores. And what do you get a future king? So what did they give him? Jewels? The latest toy? A farm animal? No. They brought gold, frankincense, and myrrh. So what in the world is a baby going to do with all of that? Well, all of these are highly valued at that time. Gold is easy. It's what we see today in jewelry or coated on the domes of some important buildings. So to me, I get that. Gold is shiny. Some capitals are covered in a thin layer of flaked gold. You can see yourself reflected in gold. When you are looking for direction in life, it's like looking for gold. Like those domes covered in the gold, you can find your way by finding those shiny beacons in the skyline. So much of life is about following Jesus' example and reflecting those values we learn, like we see our reflections in gold. So gold I get. We worship with gold by worshiping with our sight. Now, on to frankincense. Do you have any laying around the house? Do you know what it looks like? Well, if not, here is a little nugget of it, and then I have it more crushed in a little bag. I use these on my Sunday school lesson online. Frankincense is resin from a boswellia tree, and it has been used as an aroma of worship for thousands of years. Many believe that this gift pointed to Jesus being our high priest. This was one of the duties of the priest, to burn incense in the temple. Again, this pointed to Jesus. Have you ever hugged someone or smelled a scent that reminded you of someone or something? To me, smells can lift us to a time, place, or person that we know or used to know. The scent of frankincense is used as the scent of worship. Myrrh is another resin found in a tree. This is myrrh. It's just a bit darker. And it is the gift of touch. The oil of myrrh has properties of healing, and it's what is used to anoint a dead body. Today, myrrh could be used to heal sores, reduce pain, kill bacteria, all good things to make you better. So why would they give myrrh to baby Jesus? Well, if you think about it, Jesus is our myrrh. He brings healing and hope into our life. He is our healing ointment. So the wise men did, in fact, live up to their name. They are wise. They can follow directions with only a bright star and bring gifts fit for a king. While I know the gifts aren't what I would have bought, when I look at them in relation to sight, touch, and smell, I can see why they were important. And also, I can't help but wonder what a wise woman would have brought. So peace to you, and may you follow your bright star and see the reflection of God, know the smell of his presence, and the healing love of his touch.
Thank you.
Today's scripture reading is Matthew 2, 1 through 12. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the child who has been born the King of Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet. And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word, so that I may also go pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star, and they had seen it at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening the treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. May God bless this understanding of his word.
Thank you, Angie, and thank you, Dan, and thank you, David. Let's be in a spirit of prayer together. God, enter into our hearts this day. If they're kind of clogged up or full, create a little space for you and for your word. Enter into our minds this day. If they aren't open enough, open them up that we might be teachable. God, enter into our souls this day. Remind us that you have put a bit of the eternal in every one of your children and absolutely stamped your image upon all your sons and daughters. Amen. And from that text, opening their treasure chests, wise men from the east offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And being warned by God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed for their own country by another way. Going home by another way, taking a detour you never expected. January 10th, 2020, 1 year ago, this day, it was as unremarkable as any Thursday in January can be. The weather in the Boston area was balmy with a high of 52 degrees, but as always, we thought it would get mighty snowy very soon. That's New England. Football fans like me were still smarting from the Patriots' early playoff departure, but we all trusted that terrific Tom Brady, he'd come back like he always has for two decades, right? The federal government was in an uproar over a possible or feared war with Iran, and peaceful anti-war protests broke out across the United States. And buried on page 10 of the first section of the New York Times newspaper was an article I probably did not even bother to read because its headline seemed so matter of fact. Quote, "China reports first death from new virus." And the sub-headline was even more uneventful. The coronavirus, which surfaced in Wuhan has put the region on alert, but there is no evidence it can spread among humans. If only. What 12 short months, 365 days, what life can do, how life can change and changed so swiftly, how each of us as humans and we as a nation, as a world, how we suppose that we are setting out on one road, a straight road home with no detours and no surprises, and then, well, life has other plans. Life unfolds in unpredictable ways. We want to zig, and life zags. Detours, major detours, in just the last 52 weeks. And so Tom Brady now wears the colors of black, red, and orange, and is leading his Tampa Bay Buccaneers through the playoffs. Tampa Bay? And so our nation is in an uproar over a one-day protest. Okay, not a protest, but a violent insurrection, in fact. One of the ugliest days in our history as a democracy, when a mob attempted to take over the Capitol and hijack the election, and in the process caused the deaths of five people, including a police officer who on Wednesday morning, no doubt, thought his day would be just like another work day. And this day, today, that seemingly so-called unremarkable flu will in just weeks claim its 400,000th victim here in the United States. After a year like any other, a pandemic year, one we could have never ever foreseen nor ever imagined, and yet, friends, this is where the detours of life take us. Detours, unexpected, unbelievable, unprecedented, and at least this year, unrelenting. Okay, who wants to go back to January 10th, 2020? I do. And yet, of course, we cannot. And so here we are in a new year, facing life as we've rarely known it, as a church, with our remote and streaming worship and Zoom meetings and classes and no more handshakes in the receiving line and no more hugs and no more choir and many more months ahead where each of us will be challenged to have courage and faith and hope, strength for all that still lies ahead, and all because of these life detours, these detours. We are in one place and then end up, God knows, in a new place. How did we get there? Well, we make plans. We assume that life is going to go this way, and then we end up on a brand new road heading, yes, always to home, but home by another way. Detours. In his book, Learning to Fall, The Blessings of an Imperfect Life, author Philip Simmons writes, "You can't live for very long on this earth without confronting a fundamental truth. We're not in charge here, at least not entirely so. Our greatest blessings, along with our greatest burdens, seem to fall upon us unbidden. For all our planning, for all our talk of goals, for all of our strategy and vision and commitment, we learn that many of life's most important events can't be predicted or controlled. For how many of us has life turned out to be exactly what we had in mind? I'd say for none of us. I'd say that, in fact, detours are the norm in life, the norm. And they aren't always as hard or sudden or jarring or scary as those we've faced into in this past year. Sometimes detours are a miracle or a gift, like the birth of a new baby, like baby Jesus. One life enters our lives, and who among us could predict how the birth of our sons and daughters would so completely upset and upend our lives and in so many beautiful and amazing ways. Detours, like a married couple I know in their 70s. He was widowed, expecting to live out his years alone. She had never married, perhaps made her peace with living a single life, and then they reunited at a high school reunion. and then love. Love bloomed, and now they are one together. Till death do they part. Thank God for detours sometimes. Detours, case in point, our Christmas story. Mary plans to settle down with Joseph and raise some kids and live in Nazareth. But then there's a very unplanned pregnancy, and then a very unplanned place for a birth, a chilly cave. Israel plans on a mighty king to overthrow Rome, but then a little baby shows up. This kid's going to save the world. Mary and Joseph plan to go back home after the birth, but King Herod threatens the life of this little boy, and so they are forced to flee to Egypt. And of course, there are the Magi, who traveled hundreds, maybe even thousands of miles to see this new ruler. Of them, we are told, being warned of God in a dream, that they should not return to Herod. They departed for their own country by another way. By another way, by another plan, by way of a detour. For God knows, and may we know and remember, just one epiphany truth, that our life's journey is not about one predetermined master plan or a set-in-stone blueprint. Life, instead, is often more about how we respond with God's help to all of the side trips and all of the detours, to that waylay away from our path, to the surprises and the challenges and the disappointments and the unexpected, the moments when we ask, what are we supposed to do now? And so, friends, collectively, on January 10th, 2021, we are in the midst of a social and national and worldwide detour unlike any we have ever faced. How will we respond, and what is next, and what direction should we take? This is what I know and believe about detours, life detours, about the road changing beneath our feet and the days changing daily. Friends, first, I believe as Christians, as humans, and as Americans, the detours that we are in the midst of, we cannot go back. We cannot go backwards. We cannot pretend that if we just do what worked then, that everything will be all right now. No. Detours demand that you keep moving forward, that you keep moving ahead, and yes, you keep moving into the unknown even. So I believe that as a nation, there is no turning back after the events of this past Wednesday. No. I believe we are at a reckoning point as a people, as great a reckoning point as any in our 244-year history. If we do not figure out as a people how to live together in mutual respect and care, as the very diverse country that we are now, all colors and all classes and all kinds of families and so many faiths and no faiths, if we do not look to God to guide us into a new time of peace and justice from many into one body, the chaos will just continue. The violence will continue. The pain and the hurt won't go away. Friends, there is no going back. No. God be with us. We can't go back as a world either, not after COVID. We can't go back as a church either, not into this world that is so fast changing and yet still so in need of God's love and God's guidance and God's hope. I have no idea what this world is going to look like after all the vaccinations have been given. Do any of you know what's going to happen? We don't. But the truth is, we will not be the same. We will have to continue to adapt and to change and to maybe even take more detours. And yet, I do not fear this, these days ahead, these times to come that are as yet unclear, that are unfolding, because even though we detour, friends, there are two truths that never, ever change. Two truths. One, God is with us always. Two, we are to be with one another always, in the church as citizens and as inhabitants of this great blue ball spinning in space. God is with us as surely as God was with Mary and Joseph and baby Jesus and those three wise men as they took their detours. God was, God is, God will be. And friends, we have each other, one another to walk with and to be with, especially when the detour gets dark or scary or wild or weird. If I can trust that you will be with me, and if you can trust that I will be with you no matter what, detours are not that scary. Detours, in fact, sometimes can even be an adventure, looking towards a wonderful future filled with hope and even joy, but only if and when we stick together. Can I get an amen for that? Together, as a church, as families, as communities, as a nation, and as a world. Detours, to go home, yes, absolutely, but to go home by another way. May God give us all traveling mercies as we move into this new year. God keep us together. God show us the way home. Another way, but always, God, by your way. Let all God's travelers declare. Amen.
Those magic men, the Magi, some people call them wise, or Oriental, even kings. Well, anyway, those guys, they visited with Jesus, they sure enjoyed their stay. Then, warned in a dream of King Herod's scheme, they went home by another way. Yes, they went home by another way. Home by another way. Maybe me and you can be wise guys too. Go home by another way. We can make it another way. Safe home, as I used to say. Keep a weather eye to the chart on high and go home another way. Steer clear of royal welcomes, avoid a big to-do. A king who would slaughter the innocents will not cut a deal for you. He really, really wants those presents. He'll comb your camel's fur till his boys announce they found trace amounts of your frankincense, gold, and myrrh. Time to go home by another way. Home by another way. Got to figure the gods and play the odds and go home by another way. We can make it another way. Say po, as they used to say. Keep a weather eye to the chart on high and go home another way. Home is where they want you now. You can more or less assume that you'll be welcomed in the end. Mustn't let King Harry haunt you so. Or fantasize his features when you're looking at a friend. Well, it pleasures me to be here and to sing this song tonight. Tell me that life is a miracle, and I figure that they're right. But Herod's always out there, he's got our card on file. It's a lead pipe cinch if we've given it, that Herod likes to take a mile. It's best to go home by another way, home by another way. Got this far to a lucky star, but tomorrow is another day. We can make it another way. Safe home, as they used to say. Keep a weather eye to the chart on high and go home another way. Go home another way.
Friends, let's be in a spirit of prayer together. Let us pray. We offer some specific prayers at this time. We offer continuing prayers to keep ourselves safe and to keep others safe as COVID cases surge. We give prayers of deep gratitude for all those who are serving, who are helping the sick, who work in hospitals and long-term care facilities, who are first responders. We ask God have mercy. We ask continued healing for Nancy, for anyone with COVID, for Nan and her son Evan, for Betsy, for our brothers and sisters at Bethel AME, for Nancy and Ruth and Jean and Carol and Lynn and Julie. And God, in these early days of 2021, we ask you to bless us, God, with humility so that we might feel a deep sense of dependence upon you as our compass, if you will, as our true north, as that power, as that trustworthy source of spirit that will bring us back home. We ask you, God, to bless our nation with humility. Bless us with a sense of the common good and remind us that we are only as strong as all of us are together. God, we especially pray for peace, especially in these weeks as power goes from one party to another. God, we always ask you for your guidance and your presence in the days ahead. And God, we offer to you now the silent prayers of the places where we need direction as we bring you the detours we are on right now and come to you and ask for your help in getting home, especially if it's by another way. All of these things and so much more we ask in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. So I got to tell you guys some good news. Everybody, all institutions are kind of tight right now and budgets are tight and there's a lot of fear. Well, Peter, who works with our stewardship committee, sent an email out yesterday and he said we met our goal. So could I have some applause for that? Now, if you haven't given yet, don't pay any attention to that message. But in all seriousness, I have to say that I am just awed and humbled by the ways that folks in this community have been generous and have given of their time and talents. The deacons who have come here every Sunday for Doug, for David, for Angie, for the rest of the staff. You know, it's often said that crises, and I really believe this, they reveal character. They call us to our best. And so I just thank God for our community, and may God give us the strength to continue to rise up and meet whatever challenges might come our way, and may God make us a generous people as we prepare to bring our gifts to God. If you're watching at home and you'd like to make a donation, there should be a link on Facebook, or you can go straight to our webpage at pilgrimsherborne.org and hit the donate button. And so now, friends, I would invite us all to stand and sing together in one voice the doxology. Amen. Before the benediction, just a reminder to those who are here, I would ask you to remain seated until a deacon comes forward to invite you to be excused. And so, a final prayer. God, send us forth as a people of faith, deep faith, trusting in you, and then looking skyward for a star, for your star, God, for your North Star, God, that no matter where life might take us, we will continue to follow you and to take all the steps along the journey as we seek to go home, and yes, God, to go home by another way. Let all God's travelers say, Amen.